video, I'd like to talk to you and try and answer viewers' requests for tips on how to practice piano. The question isn't easy to answer and reminds me of the tutorial books I bought as a teenager on how to paint and draw. When I was at art college, I spent 1 year drawing in the life room and then 3 years painting almost exclusively nudes and portraits. How the teachers taught us painting was individual to each of them, as it was to each pupil's naturally forming painting style. What seemed to happen was students sympathised with some teachers more than others, let's say, and college life sorted itself out like that, quite naturally. If you liked a particular teacher's own painting style, you tended to ask questions and, I guess, value time spent, listen and put into practice advice given by that teacher more than a teacher's whose work you liked less. As with the books on how to draw, you really need to add the title, How to Draw Like This, as there's no one way to draw or paint. Every artist will interpret, say, a portrait in his or her own way. It's rare to find two artists that paint in exactly the same way. And the best advice can come to you when you least expect it or are even looking for it. I remember, for instance, sitting next to the British artist, the late Ruskin Spear, in our art school corridor. I was walking past and he asked to see some of my drawings in a portfolio under my arm. He looked through and drew a cube on the top of one of my drawings and said that that was the secret of drawing. It wasn't just any old cube we're familiar with in drawing lessons. And as I admired Ruskin Spear's painting, which I saw each year at the summer exhibition, that cube was magical and special. But what did it mean? I was left to figure it out on my own. Lessons are often not properly understood in the moment. They are sometimes, but not always. I realised eventually what that cube meant. It was the dotted line was missing from my drawings at that time. I realised that years later, with more experience, that brief lesson was perhaps the best lesson I've ever had. I had a piano lesson with a well-known concert pianist and conductor back in many years ago. I met him through a childhood friend that played in the symphony orchestra, and this pianist was a close friend of his, and we stayed together at his house during rehearsals of a series of concerts the British called the Proms. This pianist, booked to play several concertos with an orchestra, was practicing at my friend's house, and I painted his portrait and got to listen to him practice. We became friends and he found out I was also interested in music. I somehow got invited to the piano and attempted to play a few up-tempo Chopin preludes for him, and he gave me a short lesson. His advice was I must aim to play more deeply into the notes, as if trying to pass my fingers through the keys and leave their fingerprints on the keybed below. That was it. I have many of this pianist's CDs at home and admire his playing immensely. And this piece of advice I found over the years, like the dotted line on the cube, short advice, only a few lines and only a few words. But that's what the best advice is like, very often. I think you'll agree. Now I'll try and demonstrate what this simple piano practice advice is and remind you, it's just advice passed on to me, the advice I found the most helpful, but by no means is the only approach to piano practice, as there are as many approaches as there are pianists and painting styles as there are artists. At the end of the day, if you try it and it suits you, keep it. If not, forget it and move on. So, let's take the keys out of the piano and look at the keybed. It's a piece of flat wood, part of the piano the audience never gets to see. How are we to leave our fingerprints in the wood as we practice? I'll put back the keys, but although you can't see it, it's one of the most important parts of the piano. Although you won't be ever able to see your fingerprints in the wood. You have to imagine they are there and being replaced with every note you play. About fingers when practicing. If you've ever made fingerprints, you'll realise you don't need to crash your hand from a distance above to do this. You just have to take up ink from the ink pad, position your finger on the paper and press decisively. This is how we practice. We do this with every single finger. I'll repeat that, every single finger. If you have 10 fingers, this means 10 and not 5 or 8, which you may be doing inadvertently. We agreed to take your fingerprint. We didn't need our hand to come crashing down towards the paper. So pressing keys with all 10 fingers doesn't mean practicing particularly loudly. You'll realise this when you've been doing it for a few minutes. You don't have to concern yourself with interpretation or dynamics. Only concern yourself with 10 fingers pressing into the key bed. I was told a story about the pianist Ashkenazi. He asked the Steinway technicians to visit him in Iceland. He had rubbed off the plastic from the keys by practicing and they were to replace it. The story goes the technicians were immensely surprised as they hadn't long replaced the polymer on the keys on a previous occasion. I've had a new pupil with highly irregular playing in Chopin's Revolutionary try this practice technique and within minutes, not even hours, his playing became clear and even. When you come to blending your practice into the final interpretation with dynamics and so on, the muscular discipline or muscle memory will support all your fingers and help you play accurately and with confidence, especially at the faster tempos.